refusing its usual glow. 5 o'clock, twilight, vespers sound, and it's 6 o'clock, twilight all around.
But the sun sinks low, as low as it's going to go.
8 o'clock,
twilight,
how enthralling.
It's 9 o'clock,
twilight,
slowly crawling toward.
10 o'clock,
twilight,
crickets calling, the vespers ring, the nightingales waiting to sing, the rest of us wait on a string.
Perpetual sunset is rather an unsettling thing. During the course of one's lifetime can be vexing, but to lose one's teeth is a catastrophe. Bear that in mind, child, as you chomp so recklessly on that ginger snap.
Very well, Grandmother.
More champagne, Frid. I trust one bottle the less of Mum's 87 will not dim the hilarity at my wake.
The song.
Oh, good God, you're right.
Chandrika!
Mala, Frid, quickly. We cannot be found squatting on the grounds like bohemians.
Lawyer thinks he's going to get away with something.
Ha ha! Ha ha! Indeed, dear.
Watch him, Charlotte. Watch them both like a
hawk. I know, dear. You're a tiger, I'm a hawk. We're our own zoo.
Good day, sir. I was not aware that you were to be a fellow guest.
Neither is Miss Armfeldt. I hope our arrival will in no way inconvenience you.
Oh, not at all, not at all. I'm glad to see you've gotten through yet another week without any serious wounds.
What was that? Wounds, sir?
Rapier, bow and arrow, blow dart.
So you did come. Talk later.
Your handkerchief, Anne.
Oh, thank you.
You must have dropped it.
Your book, Master Henrik.
Thank you.
You must have dropped it.
Here, let me.
Let you what?
Ah, here you all are. Come, Malcolm.
My wife and I were in the neighborhood to visit her cousin. Unhappily, on arrival, we discovered the chateau was quarantined for,
plague.
Since I am due packed to maneuvers by dawn, we venture to propose ourselves for the night.
Well, yes, indeed, why not? Mother will be honored. Surprised, but honored. Countess Malcolm, I presume?
You do indeed, Miss Armfeldt.
Oh, and Mr. Eggum, how kind of you to come. Mother will be overjoyed.
It is your mother who is kind in inviting us. Allow me to introduce my rather antisocial son, Henrik. And this is my wife.
How do you do?
How do you do?
And this is my daughter. I'm sure you must all be exhausted after your journeys. My daughter will show you to your rooms. Mother likes dinner at 9.
Where should I put the car?
Oh, yes, the cars. Let me see.
I must speak to you at once.
Later. Perhaps the stables. They're straight ahead.
I must speak to you at once.
Later. You can't miss them. Just look for the weather vane. A huge tin cockerel. Oh, disaster, darling.
But what are you going to do? The way he glared at Mr. Eggerman, he'll kill him.
We must stay calm.
They're coming back.
Oh, God, oh, no.
But what should I say?
Anything.
Mr. Eggerman, Count Malcolm. Mother told me to tell you that she suddenly...
Oh, dear, oh, dear!
Look, is that the moon?
Yes, what a lovely afternoon.
Yes.
The evening air doesn't feel quite right.
It's a not quite glare of a not quite night. And it's wit, is that a star?
No, just the glow of a cigar.
Oh.
After I spoke to you, I thought, I will go. I won't go. And then I thought... Why not? We'll go to that dreadful woman's house, and I'll say to her, how dare you try to steal my husband? At your age, you should have acquired at least some moral sense. And then in the motor car coming here, I thought, oh dear, I'll never have the courage, and maybe it's all my fault. Oh, I want to go home.
Have no fears. Miss Armfelt has met her match.
She has? Who?
Me. When I told my husband, he instantly became a tiger. His word, of course. And then, as if from heaven, a plan flashed into my mind. Do you feel up to hearing my plan, dear? I shall make love to your husband.
You too?
Confident of my charms, I will throw myself into your husband's arms. He will succumb, why not? Carl Magnus, in a storm of jealousy, will beg my forgiveness and swear eternal fidelity. As for Miss Desiree Armfelt, she will be backpedaling her dubious commodities elsewhere. At least that is the plan.
Oh, how amusing. How extremely amusing. Oh, poor old Frederick. And it serves him right, too.
I'm not quite sure I appreciate that remark, dear.
Ah, here you are, ladies.
Oh, Mr. Eggerman. If you'll pardon my saying so, that is a simply ravishing cravat.
It is?
I can't remember when I've seen so seductive a cravat.
The atmosphere's becoming heady. The ambience thrilling.
The spirit unsteady, the flesh for to believe.
To be perpetually ready is far from fulfilling.
But wait, the sun is dipping.
Well, you're right, it's dropping. Look, at last it's slipping.
Sorry, my mistake, it's stopping.
Oh, I do agree that life at times can seem complicated.
Complicated? If you only knew. Oh, Miss...
Armfelt, I am not legitimate.
I see. Oh, Miss Armfelt, all my life I've made a fiasco of everything. If you knew how poor an opinion I have of myself, If you knew how many times I wished that I was one of the spermatozoa that never reached the womb. There, you see, I've done it again.
Mr. Eggerman, I have traveled with Mother, you know. I'm broad-minded.
You are? Then in that case, might I make a confession to you?
Of course.
I hate to burden you on so slight an acquaintance, but bottling it up inside of me is driving me insane. Oh, Miss Arnfeld, for the past 11 months, although I am preparing to enter the ministry, I...
What, Mr. Eggerman?
I have been madly, hopelessly in love with my stepmother. Do you realize how many mortal sins that involves? Damn everything to hell. I beg your pardon.
I just think that the air is still and the sun is sinking behind the hill. And when finally it sets as finally it must, when finally
it instantly rises again.
I should never have gone to the theater. And I'd never have come to the country. If I'd never have come to the country, matters might have stayed as they were.
Sir.
Sir. If she'd only been faded, if she'd only been fat, if she'd only been jaded or bursting with chat, if she'd only been perfectly awful, it would have been wonderful. If she'd been on a Twitter or elusively cold, if she'd only been bitter or better, been passably old, if she'd been covered with glitter or even been covered with mold, it would have been wonderful. But the woman was perfection, to my deepest dismay. Well, not quite perfection, I'm sorry to say. If the woman were perfection, she would go away. And that would be wonderful.
Sir, if she'd only looked flustered or admitted the worst, if she only had blustered or simpered or cursed, if she weren't so awfully perfect, it would have been wonderful. If she tried to be clever, if she'd started to flinch, if she cried or whatever a woman would do in a pinch, if I'd been certain she never again could be trusted an inch, it would have been wonderful. But the woman was perfection, not an action denied. The kind of perfection I cannot abide. If the woman were perfection, she'd have simply lied, which would have been wonderful.
If she'd only been vicious,
if she'd acted abused,
or a bit too delicious,
or been even slightly confused,
if she had only been bulky,
or bristling,
or sulky,
or bruised,
it would have been wonderful.
If
she'd only been willful,
if she only had fled,
or a little less skillful,
insulted, insisting,
in bed,
if she had only been fearful,
or fearful,
or tearful,
or dead,
it would have been wonderful.
But the woman was perfection, and the prospects are grim. That lovely perfection that nothing can dim. Yes, the woman was perfection, so I'm here with him.
Sir.
Sir. It would have been wonderful.
you wanted to see me for a moment?
But well, that child, she just said that...
Oh, you... that was just Frederica's little stratagem.
Frederica? Your daughter's name is Frederica?
Yes.
Ah, I see.
Really, Frederick? What vanity! As if you were the only Frederick in the world. Now, what was it you wanted to tell me?
Oh, as a matter of fact, I thought you should know that my wife has no inkling of the nightshirt episode, so we should be discreet.
Of course, Frederick. I wouldn't dream of giving that enchanting child a moment's anxiety.
Then you do see her charm.
Oh, how could anyone miss it? How lovely to see you, Frederick.
In spite of Count Malcolm's invasion, you sure
were happy.
Oh, God, something tells me I should make myself scarce.
Desiree!
Later, perhaps?
Anytime.
In your rooms?
In my rooms.
Desiree!
Here, dear.
That child said the green salon.
She did? Oh, how extraordinary.
Where's that goddamn lawyer?
Oh, Mr. Eggerman? Oh, somewhere about, no doubt.
What's he doing here anyway?
Well, he came to see my mother. He told you. They're the very dearest of old friends.
But it better be the truth. If I catch him so much as touching you, I'll call him out with rapiers. So where is your bedroom? Readily accessible, I trust?
Carl Magnus, with your wife here?
Charlotte is irrelevant. I shall visit your bedroom at the earliest opportunity tonight.
Madam, Count Malcolm, dinner is served.
Oh, thank you.
Dinner is served, Mr. Eggerman.
There you are, Mr. Eggerman. Gentlemen, shall we proceed? Mr. Eggerman. How splendid.
I was rather proud of myself, yes.
And were you tremendously proud of him too, Mrs. Eggerman?
I beg your pardon. Oh, I expect so, although I don't seem to remember much about it.
I try not to bore my wife with my dubious victories in the courtroom.
How wise you are. I remember when I was her age. Anything less than a new dress or a ball or a thrilling piece of gossip bored me to tears.
That is the charm of youth.
Dearest Miss Arnfeldt,
Do regale us with more fascinating reminiscences of your remote youth.
Charlotte, that is an idiotic remark.
A man's youth may be as remote as a dinosaur, Countess. But with a beautiful woman, youth merely accompanies her through the years.
Oh, Mr. Eggerman, that is too enchanting. And, dear, where on earth did you find this simply adorable husband?
I'm glad you approve of him.
Your father is irresistible. I shall monopolize him for the entire weekend. Will you lease him to me, dear?
Freely. He's all yours. Unless, of course, our hostess has other plans for him.
I had thought of seducing him into rolling the croquet lawn tomorrow, but I'm sure he'll find the Countess less exhausting.
I wouldn't guarantee that. Oh, how could those wicked words have passed these lips?
Charlotte!
Oh, come, Agnes, dear, don't say you're bristling. My husband, Mr. Eggerman, is a veritable porcupine. At the least provocation, he is all spine. Or is it quills? Beware. I am leading you down dangerous paths.
I apologize for my wife, sir. She is not herself tonight.
If she is this charming when she is not herself, sir, then I would be fascinated to meet her when she is.
Bravo! Bravo, my champion! May tomorrow find us thigh to thigh, pushing the garden roller in tandem.
Well, that would depend on the width of the roller. Miss Armfeld, there's a stranger in this house.
A stranger, sir? How can you call yourself a stranger in this house?
I beg your pardon. What I meant to say
is that I understand from your daughter, madam, that Mr. Eggerman is an old friend of yours, and consequently a frequent visitor to this house.
Are you speaking to me, sir, whoever you might be?
I am, madam.
Then kindly repeat yourself, sir.
Mother,
judging from the level of the conversation this evening, you can hardly expect me to have been paying attention.
Splendid! The thrust direct. I shall commandeer that remark and wreak havoc with it at all my husband's regimental dinner parties.
Dessert wine. It is from the cellar of the King of the Belgians, who, during a brief period of intense intimacy, presented me with every bottle then in existence. Its secret quality is unknown, but it is said to open the eyes of even the blindest among us. To life!
To life!
And to the only other reality, death!
Myself. What an unusual sensation. Dearest Miss Armfront, at this awe-inspiring moment, let me drink to you who have made this evening possible. The one and only Desiree Armfelt, beloved of hundreds, regardless, of course, of their matrimonial obligations.
Charlotte, you will go to your room immediately.
Miss Armfield, I'm sure what the Countess is trying to...
Oh, dear, I am beside myself.
Stop it! All of you, stop it!
Henrik!
Are you reproving me?
I think if I were you, I would sit down.
Sit, Henrik. Stand, Henrik. Am I to spend the rest of my life at your command, like a lapdog? Am I to respect a man who would allow such filthy pig's talk in front of the purest, the most innocent, the most wonderful? I despise you all.
How silly, Henrik. How comical you look.
Smash this tube. Smash every glass in the house if you feel like it.
You, you're an artist. You play Ibsen and Racine. And don't any of the great truths of the artists come through to you at all? Are you no better than the rest of them?
Why don't you just laugh at us all, my dear? Wouldn't that be a better solution?
How can I laugh when life makes me want to vomit?
Poor silly Henrik. Someone should go after him.
And come back.
Offer a suggestion that you try holding your breath for a very long time.
Acting like a madman, breaking in an expensive glass, humiliating myself in front of them all.
Poor Mr. Eggerman.
They laughed at me. Even Anne. She said, "Silly Henrik, how comical you look." Laughter. How I detest it. Your mother. Everyone says laugh at it all, but if all you can do is laugh at the cynicism, the frivolity, the lack of heart, then I'd rather be dead.
Henrik?
Oh, God, there she is.
Mr. Eggerman, please don't do anything,
dear.
Oh, Mrs. Eggerman, I'm so terribly worried.
Oh, your poor dear, what about?
Mr. Eggerman, Junior, that is.
Oh, silly Henrik, I just came out here to scold him.
But Mrs. Eggerman, I am so afraid he may do himself an injury.
How delightful it is to be talking to someone younger than myself. No doubt he was denouncing the wickedness of the world and quoting Martin Luther. My dearest Frederica, all you were witnessing was the latest crisis in his love affair with God.
Not with God, Mrs. Eggerman, with you.
Me?
You may not have noticed, but he is madly, hopelessly in love with you.
Is that really the truth?
Yes, he told me so, himself.
Oh, the poor dear boy. How ridiculous of him. And yet, how charming. Oh, dear friend, if you only knew how insecure I constantly feel, how complicated the marriage state seems to be. Oh, I adore old Frederick, of course, but
Mrs. Eggerman, he ran down towards the lake.
Gaze over the ornamental waters. How touching. Such a good-looking boy, isn't he? Such long, long lashes.
Who needs a haystack? Anything you've got to show, you can show me right here. That is, if you're in the mood.
When am I not in the mood?
I wouldn't know, would I? I'm just passing through!
I'm in the mood! I'm in it 24 hours a day.
Mr. Eggerman!
Private here, isn't it?
Henrik?
What are they up to?
Oh, them. What are they ever up to?
Henrik? Mr. Eggerman!
You saw them at dinner, dressed up like waxworks, jabbering away to prove how clever they are, and never knowing what they meant.
Henrik!
Well, catch one of them having the sense to grab the first pretty girl that comes along and make love to her in the soft grass with the summer night smiling down. Any complaints?
Give me time.
You have a sweet mouth. As sweet as honey.
Your dragoon and his wife are glowering at each other in the green salon, and all the children appear to have vanished. So when I saw you sneaking up the stairs, I thought...
Well, perhaps... I ripped my hem on the dining room table and all that furor.
Is, this all right?
Of course. Sit down.
On the stockings.
I don't see why not. Well, we're back at the point where we were so rudely interrupted last week.
Not quite. If you remember, we progressed a step further.
How true.
I imagine neither one of us is contemplating a repeat performance.
Oh, Frederick, with your wife here, and my lover and his wife, and my daughter.
Oh, and my devoted old friend, your mother.
Oh, isn't my dragoon awful?
Oh, when you said he had the brain of a pea, I think you were being generous.
Oh, what in God's name are we laughing about? Your son was right at dinner, you know. We don't fool that boy, not for a moment. The one and only Desiree Armfelt, dragging around the country in shoddy tours, carrying on with someone else's dim-witted husband. And the great lawyer Eggerman, busy renewing his unrenewable youth.
Well, bravo. Probably that's an accurate description of us both.
Shall I tell you why I really invited you here? When we met again and we made love, I thought, maybe here it is at last, a chance to turn back, to find some sort of coherent existence after so many years of muddle. Of course, there's your wife, but I thought perhaps, just perhaps, you might be in need of rescue, too.
From renewing my unrenewable youth.
It was just a thought.
Desiree, when my eyes are open and I look at you, I see a woman that I have loved for a long time, who entranced me all over again when I came to her rooms. A woman who gives me such genuine pleasure that, in spite of myself, I came here for the sheer delight of being with her again. The woman who could rescue me, of course. But when my eyes are not open, which is most of the time, all I see is a girl in a pink dress teasing a canary, running through a sunlit garden to hug me at the gate as if I'd come home from Timbuktu, instead of the municipal courthouse, 3 blocks away.
Isn't it rich? Are we a pair? Me here at last on the ground. Send in the clouds. Isn't it bliss? Don't you approve? One who keeps tearing around, one who can't lose. And where are the clowns? Send in the clowns. Just when I'd stopped.
was yours.
Making my entrance again with my usual flair. Sure of my lines, no one is there. Don't you love farce? My fault, I fear. I thought that you'd want what I want. Sorry, my dear. And where are the clowns? Quick, send in the clowns. Don't bother, they're here.
Desiree, I'm sorry. I should never have come. To flirt with rescue when one has no intention of being saved is... Do try to forgive me.
Isn't it rich? Isn't it queer? Losing my timing this late in my career. And where are the clowns? There ought to be clowns. Well, maybe next
Pavilion, and then, of course, there's the stables.
Then you go to the stables, and I'll take the summer pavilion. Run! Isn't this exciting after that stodgy old dinner?
Miller's son, pin my
Friday nights for a bit of fun, we'll go dancing. Meanwhile, it's a wink and a wiggle and a giggle on the grass and I'll trip the light bandango. A pinch and a diddle in the middle of what passes by. It's a very short rope from the pinch and the punch to the punch and the pouch and the pension. Friday nights, if we think we can, we'll go dancing. Meanwhile, it's a push and a bumble and a tumble in the sheets, and I'll put the Highland fancy, a dip in the butter and a flutter with what meets my eye. It's a very short bench from the push and the whoop to the squint and the stoop and the mumble. Bed to be sampled and seen in the meanwhile, and a girl has to celebrate what passes by, or I shall marry the Prince of Wales. Pearls and servants and dressing for festivals, Friday nights with him all. We'll have dancing. Meanwhile, it's a rip in the bustle and a rustle in the hay, and I'll pitch the quick fantastic with flings of confetti and my petticoats way up high. It's a very short way from the fling that's for fun to the thigh pressing under the table. It's a very short day till you're stuck with just one, or it has to be done on. Bed. There's a lot I'll have missed, but I'll not have been dead when I die. And a person should celebrate everything passing by. And I shall marry the miller's son.
I was looking for my wife.
Oh, Mr. Eggerman, how can I face you after that exhibition at dinner? Throwing myself at your head?
On the contrary, it was most morale building. It's not often these days that a beautiful woman does me that honor.
I didn't.
I beg your pardon?
I didn't do you that honor. It was just a charade, a veiled charade. In my madness, I thought I could make my husband jealous.
Well, I'm afraid marriage isn't one of the easier relationships.
Mr. Eggerman, for a woman, it's impossible.
It's not all that possible for man.
Man? Look at you. A man of an age when a woman is lucky if a drunken alderman pinches her derriere at a village fete. And yet, You have managed to acquire the youngest, prettiest. I hate you being happy. I hate anyone being happy.
The gig should be ready at the stable.
Oh, Henrik, darling, I do hope the horses are smart. I do detest riding in a gig where the horses are not smart.
Think of how I adore you. Think of how much you love me. If I were perfect for you, wouldn't you tie your old me soon?
Let all the birds nest in my hair.
Silly Henry, quick or we'll miss the train.
It was, wasn't it?
It was.
Run after them, quick. You can catch them at the stables.
After the horses have gone. How strange. To have one's life end while sitting on a bench in a garden.
She lightens my sadness. She livens my day. She bursts with a kind of madness my well-ordered way. The happiest mistake, the ache of my life.
Carl Magnus, go away.
I'd have been here half an hour ago if I hadn't had to knock a little sense into my wife.
Carl Magnus, don't take off your jacket.
Poor girl. She was somewhat the worse for wine, of course, trying to make me believe that she was attracted to that asinine lawyer fellow.
Carl Magnus, listen to me. It's over. It was never anything in the first place, and now it's over.
Of all people, that lawyer, a rank coward without a hair on his body, probably.
Oh, don't take off your trousers!
Poor girl. She'd slash her wrist before she'd let any other man touch her. And even if, under the influence of wine, she did stray a bit, how ridiculous to imagine that I would so much as turn a hair. Good God!
What is it?
It's her and him sitting on a bench. She's touching him. Oh, the scoundrel, the conniving swine. Any man thinks he can lay a finger on my wife.
Carl Magnus, what are you doing?
My dueling pistols.
Oh, hey. No, no.
There seems to be a great deal going on in this house this evening. Child, do me a favor.
Of course, Grandmother.
Tell me what it's all for. Having lost my illusion centuries ago, it would be soothing at least to pretend to share some of yours.
Well, I think it must be worth it.
Why?
It's all there is, isn't it? Oh, I know it's often discouraging. And to hope for something too much is childish, because what you want so rarely happens.
Astounding. When I was your age, I wanted everything. The moon, jewels, yachts, villas on the Riviera. And I got them too, for all the good it did me. There was a Croatian count. He was my first lover. I can see him still. That mustache. And those eyes. He gave me a wooden ring.
A wooden ring?
Seems it had been in his family for centuries. And I said to myself, a wooden ring? What sort of man would give a woman a wooden ring? So I threw him out, then and there. And now, who knows, he might have been the great love of my life.
To think I was actually saying how I hate you being happy. It's as if I carry around some terrible curse. Oh, Mr. Eggerman, I'm sorry.
Sir! You will accompany me to the pavilion.
Carl Magnus.
I think the situation speaks for itself.
Carl Magnus, dear, you won't be too impulsive, will you?
Whatever the provocation, I remain a civilized man. The lawyer and I are merely going to play a little Russian roulette.
Russian roulette?
Well, sir, are you ready, sir?
I beg your pardon. Ready for what?
Russian roulette!
Oh, Russian roulette. Well, that's with a gun, isn't it? And you spin the, well, why not? Excuse me, madam.
A weekend in the country, so inactive that one has to lie down. A weekend in the country, where Christ is upset as in town.
What is it? What's happened?
My husband and Mr. Eggerman are dueling in the pavilion.
Are you insane? You let them do it? Oh, you lunatic! You killed him! Oh, Frederick!
My dear Miss Armfelt, he merely grazed his ear. I trust his performance in the law courts is a trifle more professional. I am prepared to forgive you, dear, but I feel this house is no longer a suitable place for us.
Yes, my darling, I agree.
You will pack my things and meet me in the stables. I will have the car ready.
Yes, dear. Oh, Carl Magnus, you became a tiger for me.
Men are stupid, men are vain, love's disgusting. Love's insane, a humiliating business.
Oh, how true.
Ah, well.
Frederick, Frederick.
I don't suppose this is my heavenly reward.
Hardly, dear, with me here.
Extraordinary. To hold a muzzle to one's temple and yet to miss.
Does it hurt?
It hurts spiritually. You've heard, I imagine, about the evening's other event.
No, what?
Henrik and Anne ran off together.
Oh, Frederick.
Well, I think it's time I got up and confronted the world. Don't you?
Isn't it rich?
Are we a pair? You here at last on the ground?
You in midair? Knees wobbling?
No, no, it seems not. In fact, it hardly seems possible, but...
Don't you like farce?
My fault, I fear.
Me as a merry-go-round.
Me as King Lear. How unlikely life is. To lose one's son, one's wife, and practically one's life within an hour, and yet to feel relieved. Relieved, and what's more, considerably less ancient.
Poor Frederick.
No, no, no. We shall banish the word poor from our vocabulary and replace it with coherent.
Coherent?
Oh, don't you remember your manifesto in the bedroom? Coherent existence after so many years of muddle. You and me. And of course, Frederica.
They're finally
Malmo appeal to you? It should be high sunburn season.
Why not?
Why not?
Oh, God.
What's wrong?
Oh, I've got to do Hedda for a week in Helsingborg.
Well, what's wrong with a little purgatory before paradise? I shall sit through all 8 performances.
Don't you think you should go to bed, Grandmother?
I shall stay up all night and wait for the first cock's crow of the morning. He has come to be my only dependable friend.
Grandmother.
What, child?
I've watched and watched, but I haven't noticed the knight smiling.
Young eyes are not ideal for watching. They stray too much. The summer night has already smiled. Twice.
It has? Twice? For the young and the fools?
The smile for the fools was particularly broad tonight.
So there's only the last to come.
Yes, only the last.